Strange as it may seem, the name of Mary, the mother of Jesus, does not feature regularly in the traditional Christmas carols. In our opening carol, however, it did, and it is my intention this Christmas Day to focus on Mary. For Christ is born of Mary and gathered all above, while mortals sleep, the angels keep their watch of wondering love. There is a danger that in the clutter and peripheries of Christmas, God's message of salvation for all humanity can be so overwhelmed that it loses its simplicity and essence. I must confess that as I prepared the Advent presentations this year, I wondered if all that surrounds Christmas is so overwhelming that when we finally arrive at Christmas Day, that there is a sense of an anticlimax. I think Mary's response to the angel that brings the news of her child is a simple and clearly focused pattern of how we connect with God.
Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" And the angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also, that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible." Then Mary said, "Behold the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her.
Even though we think we know a great deal about Mary, the mother of Jesus, how much do we actually know? Is there anything we can learn about Mary from modern scripture studies, archaeological research, and literature of her time? In contrast to the charming paintings of primitive artists and the tranquil compositions of musicians and poets, reality may be quite different. As far as we can tell, Mary was born in Nazareth, a Galilean town with a population of around 1600, during the reign of Herod the Great, a violent puppet king kept in power by the Roman military. As a matter of fact, Nazareth was not highly regarded by most Jews, and the comment from John 1:46 highlights that. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? It is not mentioned in the Hebrew scriptures or in the Talmud, nor is it referred to in any of the earliest Jewish texts. There is a good possibility that Mary spoke Aramaic with a Galilean accent. At odds with many of the artistic images of Mary, a waif-like figure with blonde hair and blue eyes, the reality may well have been that of a strong peasant girl with dark hair and dark eyes, used to helping with the manual labour from an early age. She probably lived in an extended family unit like most people at that time, where three or four houses of one or two rooms each were built around an open courtyard in which relatives shared an oven, a cistern, a millstone to grind grain, and where domestic animals also resided. The culture of the day demanded that women ordinarily married at about 13 years of age in order to guarantee their virginity and capitalize on their childbearing years. Accordingly, it is possible that Mary was very young at the time of her engagement to Joseph and when she gave birth to Jesus. In Luke 1, we have this extraordinary story of the angel's announcement to Mary, bearing in mind that this is a girl in her early teens. It was an announcement that would change the history of the world and the lives of countless people for the better. Mary leaves us a simple pattern to follow in our relationship with God. Behold the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. In the redemptive plan of God, this young woman from a humble background becomes a central figure in God's plan to redeem the world. Using this young peasant girl as God's choice challenges social norms and expectations in a way that demonstrates God's divine preference for the poor and the marginalized. Throughout the Bible, there are many examples of God using the weak and the humble for his purposes, and Mary's selection is no exception. I suspect there are times when the Nativity narrative can become complex and overworked, and we miss something of the simplicity of the birth of the Saviour of all mankind. Perhaps in the humility of this peasant girl's response to the angel Gabriel, there is a fundamental and straightforward pattern for a meaningful relationship with God. For this young teenage girl, there must have been an overwhelming sense of surprise, alarm, and bewilderment. She had little in the way of life experience to call on, and she appears to be alone when the event happens. At that moment, she may not have wanted to have found favour with God or be blessed among women. No doubt, the whole scenario was unsettling, frightening, and puzzling. There are times in our relationship with God we want to step away from his will, as it may overwhelm and puzzle us. However, there is something very fundamental at work here that we need to not only understand, but also embrace. God is sovereign, and until we have settled this fundamental question of the absolute authority of God, it will be very difficult to have a meaningful relationship with him. Mary quickly settles the question by calling herself a maidservant of the Lord. She acknowledges her status as the servant of the Lord. She recognizes God's authority and ownership over her life. Any meaningful relationship with God begins with a realization and acknowledgement of God's sovereignty. In doing so, we express the belief that God possesses ultimate authority, control, and power over our life and all the things in the universe, and nothing happens outside of his control. Lord, all sovereign, granting peace from heaven, let me comfort those who suffer with the comfort you have given. I will tell of your great love for as long as I live, singing, "What a faithful God have I." What is obvious here is that Mary intentionally and without question acquiesces in authentic humility to the will of God. Those who would acknowledge God as absolute sovereign must be of the same mindset, a readiness and a willingness to comply without question to the will of God whom we see as sovereign. The litmus test of such obedience comes to a crisis point when God's will collides with our own preferences. While ever life is pleasant and agreeable, so long as our spiritual journey is tranquil and congenial, there is no challenge to faith. However, when personal inclination and desires clash with the will of a sovereign God, the need for obedience and implicit faith becomes a reality. To do the will of God is a high pinnacle of spiritual experience. But to lovingly do the will of God is to know authentic intimacy with Him. Here is where the legalist and the recipient of grace part company. He who fulfills the will of God as a legal obligation finds little satisfaction and little personal communion. But he who, like Mary, lovingly carries out the will of his Father, knows the measureless love and intimacy that God desires for all of his children. All worldly experiences and encounters will fade with the passing of time and eventually be relegated to history. But those who in love do God's will reap a reward of a growing relationship with God. For Mary, the quiet, compliant acceptance of God's way was evident in her words, "Let it be to me." There is an unmistakable example here for us to follow. No doubt, Mary would have been totally confused, bewildered, and frightened beyond all understanding by not only the angel's message, but also the very appearance of a heavenly messenger. No doubt, in the back of her mind would have been thoughts of the reaction of her family and her society. A pregnant 14-year-old would be a disgrace to her family and fodder for village gossip. She would have been well aware that for the next 9 months she would be the focus of furtive glances, behind-the-hand whispers and snide comments. Life may well become challenging because of her response, "Let it be to me according to your word." Such a response is an act of faith and acceptance and confidence in the grace of God. Only by grace can we enter. Only by grace can we stand. Not by our human endeavor, but by the blood of the Lamb. There is a sense in which such a response is a commitment to the acceptance of God's grace. And the truth is that grace provides an awareness of security that is not easily shaken. Grace is often more apparent when life is at its darkest, because at that point all the materialistic facades behind which we hide are shattered and we are cast utterly on the grace of God. The very residence of God is a place of immeasurable grace. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace. Here is the very fountain of grace itself, flowing from the throne of God, and we are invited to come at any moment, totally unrestrained, to that very source of grace. It is here we find mercy, understanding, and forgiveness, and grace to meet every situation in life. There are times in our lives, like Mary, when the way of God may seem far beyond our comprehension, when what is happening in our world is incomprehensible and puzzling beyond belief, and we have to utter, like Mary, "Let it be to me according to your word." It is in these situations that we need to seek God's grace and accept it, however it may come. Can I suggest to you that Mary's response to God is an excellent adage by which we can live? However, it is a motto that will require courage and faith to utter in all circumstances. Let it be to me according to your word. This motto or adage echoes down through the centuries and finds some resonance in the Beatles' hit Let It Be, written by Paul McCartney following a dream about another Mary, Mary Patricia McCartney, his mother who died of cancer when he was 14. When asked if the phrase Mother Mary in the song referred to Mary, the mother of Jesus, McCartney has typically replied that listeners can interpret the song however they like. And perhaps that is what we will do as we listen to the International Staff Band of the Salvation Army playing the song Let It Be. Thank you. Mary's response in Luke 1:38 serves as a testament to her faith and her willingness to surrender to the will of God. "Let it be to me according to your word," reflects a profound acceptance of God's plan despite its mystery and potential social repercussions. It was an acceptance of the incomprehensible, and it is Mary's absolute acceptance of God's will that makes her an essential character in the narrative of salvation. It is through Mary's acceptance that God enters human history through Jesus Christ. It is also important to note that Mary's willing response highlights the importance of human beings in God's plan. While the angelic announcement demonstrates God's sovereignty, Mary's free and willing consent underscores the cooperative nature of God's relationship with humanity. Mary's response shows the relationship between divine initiative and human response, emphasizing the importance of human partnership in the redemptive work of God. No doubt, modern employers would have quickly passed over Mary's application to bear the Son of God. Poorly educated, not the right look, poorly dressed and presented, and spoke with a questionable accent. Just not a suitable candidate. However, God thought otherwise, and herein is a powerful lesson for all Christians, regardless of class, education, appearance, or social standing. The reality is that all human beings are faulty, and the incredible thing is that God still trusts and uses them if, like Mary, they come with the same attitude. "Behold the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." Holy Jesus, every day keep us in the narrow way, and when earthly things are past, bring our ransomed souls at last, where they need no starter guide, where no clouds thy glory hide.